What's up? So today I wanted to make a quick little video. I hope quick, but as if you guys ever watch my videos, I like to ramble. I wanted to make a quick little video about why film and watching film of throwers and you throwing is very important, but also I think misutilized and sometimes done at the wrong times. So let's start first with why watching film yourself is important. And one of the obvious things that we could start off with is, you know, if you're having like a bad practice, whip out your phone, have someone record you or find some way to record yourself, and it can show you what you're doing wrong when you have like no feeling for the implement that you're throwing. You're just having one of those days. Every thrower has one of those days where you just feel nothing. You're just everything's going terrible. So that's a good time. Maybe whip out your phone. And if you notice something egregiously wrong, like that you're doing that you couldn't feel, that's a good way to use film and video. All right. Another good way to use video is if you're trying to go to that next level, and you mastered all the basics and stuff, you can whip out film and see some little things that you do wrong. You know, like maybe you never noticed that you dropped your heel a little bit in the middle of the ring for shot put and discus, or maybe you didn't notice like on your third turn of hammer that you always kind of pull your left shoulder if you're a right-handed thrower, or just things like that that maybe you weren't advanced enough to feel or know, but watching it in video, you know, it makes it pretty obvious because, you know, you can see it. So that's when I think it's a good, like, for example, I never really noticed that I dropped my right heel in the middle as much as I did. I knew I did a little because I have a previous ankle injury history, but I didn't know that much. And I didn't know that I didn't actually work the ground when I was in college and all that until my coach filmed me and point that out, and that drastically changed how I threw for the better. So that's just little things can help a long way, because little things in throwing sometimes can make the biggest leaps. All right. So, and it's a good way to humble yourself too. You know, if you think you have perfect technique, like I thought I did, because back in high school everyone told me I did, but the second I went to college, people were like, your technique sucks, it's super inefficient. And at first I was like, hey, screw all you. But then when I actually sat down and looked at my videos, video of me throwing, I was like, oh yeah, I don't work the ground. I pull off the finish. I go way too fast out the back. I do all these things that make my throw go way less than it should. So those are things that video can really help with. All right. So before we get to some other stuff, let me now do the downsides of looking videos of yourself. So one of the downsides is that if you do a video of each throw of your entire practice, one that's just an inefficient practice, because you're going to just spend half the time just looking through your videos, setting up the camera, resetting up the camera and all that. And you know, that just takes up a bunch of time. So it adds about like another like half hour to your practice that doesn't even need to be there. All right. And also, two, you don't need to watch every film, like every video of yourself. There's times of the year, like the off season, I think is good for video. When you're having, like I said, like a horrible day, you just don't know what's happening. Your coach really can't see what's happening. That's a good time to watch video. But during season, I tend to personally lean towards you want to feel what you're doing wrong. Because if you rely just simply on film, you're never going to actually learn. You're never going to actually gain the muscle memory of what it's supposed to look like. You know, just because you do it once good on film doesn't mean you can do it again. You need to actually feel what it's like. And, you know, you're not going to be able to watch film during a meet, first of all. I think they changed that rule actually, but for the most part, I mean, you shouldn't really watch film yourself. Most of the best throwers of all time, like John Godina, for example, In the in-season, he never videoed any of his throws in practice. He never looked at film of himself because he was only concentrating on feeling his positions, feeling what's happening. All right? So that's something that's a downside of film if used in-season. Now, obviously, I mean, like, you can... Like, if you're having, like, a crazy good day or something, you know, whip out the camera, just, you know, like, film a couple of throws just because, you know, you want to have that memory, like, a mental picture of what that's supposed to look like, of what a good throw for you is. And, you know, because, you know, it may be a far throw. So, everyone likes far throws. So, that's not bad, but I wouldn't, like... It's okay to take video and stuff in season, but I wouldn't analyze it. I wouldn't, like, look too deep into it. Because by in season, you should have your technique dialed by then. If it's not, then that's a different problem that has nothing to do with video. All right? That's just something completely different that I'm not going to talk about, right, in this video. So that's something that I think is a negative to video. And... Another negative for watching yourself for video is if you're in season again, you tend to overanalyze everything, all right? You start seeing, like, little things that you do that, in the grand scheme of things, aren't things that you need to be working on in season, but your mind is, and you, especially if you're an inexperienced thrower, will get obsessed over these little things because you want everything to be perfect in season. It's never going to be perfect. There's no such thing as a perfect throw, all right? Not even Ryan Krause or not even the world record holders have the perfect throw. Because, you know, and I bet he'll say that too. Me personally, I've never liked any throw that I've ever done. I've never looked at a throw that I've done or felt a throw that I've done that said, and I said, wow, that was perfect. Even my PR throws didn't stay on the ground flat. Didn't hold a block very well. Three things right off the bat. But if you obsess over those things, you're just going to drive yourself crazy. And you're not going to get any progress done. You're just going to feel down on yourself all the time. So that's... that. And you don't want that. You know, you don't want that ever. But you especially don't want that in season. You know, you want to feel confident in your technique. You want to feel confident in yourself. Even if your technique sucks... Even if you're bad at throwing, or not as experienced, I should say. You know, you don't want to make yourself feel worse, you know. So, that's another reason why film, I think, in season is not very good. Alright? Now, obviously, like I said, if you're having, like, one of those terrible days where, like, you can't feel anything, then whip out the film. Alright? But, let me watch. Oh, okay, cool. I'm good on time. I don't want my camera to time out. So, yeah, so I think that covers everything, about filming yourself. Now let's move on to why I think you should watch videos of other throwers, pro throwers, good throwers. Alright, so there are certain negatives, certain positives. So let's go over the positives first. One, because... You know, they're really good at what they do. You know, if you watch like a 22-meter shot putter, they probably are doing something right. Nobody throws over 22 meters without doing at least like a lot of things right. All right? You can't have bad technique and throw 22 meters right off the bat. So now a lot of them may do quirky stuff, and we'll get into that. But for the most part, I like, especially for inexperienced people, taking a video of a really, really good thrower, like a world-class thrower, and just showing them positions, and not just one, but multiple of them, and I'll show them the similarities in all the positions they hit, because all of them get over their left, all of them hold their chest in the middle, all of them land in the middle, all of them land with stacked over their power position, all of them work... For the most part, work the ground really well. All of them stay on the implement really well. And all of them hold a block really well. Alright? For the most part. Some exceptions. But for the most part, about like 90% of them do. So, That's something that I show. Like, the first thing I do when I'm teaching a beginner is I just show them video of just throwers, just to get a mental picture of what a throw and what the end goal is supposed to look like. All right? Now, you got to let them know, if you're coaching young throwers, you got to let them know, like, don't expect to throw like this in like a year. You know, they've been doing this for many, many, many years, decade plus years. So, you know, no rush, but, you know, it's a good mental thing for a beginner and even an intermediate or advanced thrower to know, like, have a visual picture of what a good throw is supposed to look like. You know, like, I see all the time, like, people watch videos of, like, college throwers and stuff, and I generally don't like that unless they are, like, really, like, top-class throwers. Someone like Turner Washington or someone like that, you know, that, you know, throw really far. Because for the most part, you know, collegiate athletes sometimes don't have the best technique. A lot of them don't. I've competed against several, like, 18-plus-meter throwers. Do not, like, they like, do some stuff correctly. A lot of it is just their strength. You know, when you squat 700 pounds and bench like 500 pounds, you can get away with some stuff. But we'll get into that in the negatives of watching film. Okay? But I tend to watch world-class throwers, but I tend to pick ones that are consistent. So I'm not going to pick a thrower who's thrown like 70 meters once. All right? And then like not even gotten close since. Dakers. So I'm not going to do that. All right, because my definition of good technique is repeatable, consistent technique. All right, I don't really care if you threw far once in your entire life if you can't even come close to it ever again. All right, so one of the reasons why Ryan Crouser and Joe Kovacs are considered really good technical models is because they are consistent 22 plus meter throws every competition, basically. They are over 22 meters, all right? So, and for Ryan Crouser, it's 23 meters. But whatever, screw that guy. So that's what I'm saying. Like, Gerd Kanter, I think, is an amazing technical model because he's consistently over 70 meters. You know, Robert Harding, Lars Riedel, really good technical models. You know, consistently over 68-plus meters. Christian Che, another good technical model. Just... yeah, you got to find consistent throwers to be technical models and to actually watch for technique. Now, I watch a lot of... I just watch throws just because I'm a fan of the sport and I just watch them. I just watch everything just because, you know, I love the sport. But just because you like a thrower does not mean you should use them as a technical model. You know, like, I love Adam Nelson. Would never use him as a technical model for really anybody. I can't really see that many scenarios unless someone just does what he did with his left leg naturally, like what he did. I don't really see me coaching that. And there's a reason why you've never really seen anybody since Adam Nelson do exactly what he's done. Because, you know, he can repeat it sometimes. He was a little inconsistent too, but for the most part, he could replicate what he threw, what like how he threw. But yeah, so you got to find a technical model that's good for you. So that's why video is important. Watching other throwers throw, like elite throwers throw, is because you can find a technical model and you got to, I know sometimes it's hard to find technical, like another way to find technical model. Sorry, this video isn't about this, but I just want to give this one piece of advice if you're trying to find a technical model. Try and find someone that's built for you and has like the same attributes as you. So if you're super mobile and super flexible, you know, find someone that throws like that. You know, if you're super bulky and strong and like just round, find someone like that to base your technique off of. And I would say try and find someone that is your height, around your height and weight, because the height and weight of a thrower really affects the way they throw. All right, especially the height. So, yeah. But I know it's hard because, you know, I'm 5'10", and when I threw discus, really nobody was good and threw 5'10". Like, nobody's like a 60... Like, I can't really think of anybody who is like a 70-meter discus thrower who's 5'10". You know, there have been a couple that are like 6'1", but for the most part, like 5'10", no, not really. Unless I'm mistaken, but I haven't found one yet. So, yeah. I know it's hard. Trust me, I know it's hard. Shot put, it's a little easier because a lot of rotational throwers are a lot shorter, for the most part. So, that's your best bet. And hammer throwers generally aren't that tall, too. But, yeah. But, yeah, so I just wanted to mention that. But let's get back to the subject of the video before I get onto a ramble. So, where was I? Oh, yes. Watching professionals do film. All right. So, watching professionals do film. Wait, what? No, that doesn't make any sense. I'm sorry. Watching professionals throw. There we go. Big brain here. What was I going to say? Oh, yes. So, we already went over why it's a good thing. Because it gets that mental picture in your head of what a good throw looks like. You can compare yourself to... you could do a side-by-side comparison of yourself throwing and this person throwing, and see what they do versus what you do. And maybe you can find something that's a weakness in your throw, or a weakness in their throw. Maybe you do something better than them. Who knows? I don't know you. But for the most part, it's probably they are doing something better than you, which is, you know, why they throw further than you. So that's something to keep in mind, because that can point out weaknesses in your throw and stuff. And another reason, you know, it's just enjoyable to just watch people throw far, you know. That's, you know, like, it's a great inspirational thing to want to be like someone who throws 22 plus meters. Because at the end of the day, you know, that's the whole point of the sport, to throw as far as possible. And these people are. So, that's something to keep in mind. Now, there are some negatives. I think I listed all positives. Yeah, there are some negatives to watching elite throwers throw on film. One, I would highly recommend not watching a lot of their competition throws. And I'm going to explain why. It's a little controversial topic, but what I tend to like is, if I'm looking for a technical analysis, I like doing training throws, because one, training throws are actually thinking a lot more about their technique than in a competition. So usually, actually, their practice throws will be further. Two, a lot of people actually throw further in practice than they do at a meet. I know you're not supposed to, but, you know, like, for instance, Joe Kovacs, he's throwing like 24 freaking meters in practice, hasn't done it in a meet, or just some ridiculous stuff like that. You know, he's had warm-up throws way over 23 meters, like 2380, hasn't done it in a meet. And, you know, part of it is because they're actually thinking about technique, because they're practicing. In a meet, they're not going to think about technique, because they don't need to. It would be stupid to, honestly, because it causes you to overthink. The most you should ever think about in a meet is literally one cue. And that's only if you are having a bad meet and you just need something to think about that you're doing wrong. But for the most part, I just tell all my athletes, don't think. Because if you have to think about what you're doing during a meet, then that's a problem. All right? You should already be dialed in, know what to do, all right? So I tend to watch, if I'm doing analysis videos, technical throws from elite shot putters and elite throwers in practice, all right? Because they're thinking about technique. So you may see a lot of throwers in competition, their technique isn't as dialed in. Like, it's still, like, very good, obviously. Like, if anybody else were to throw like that, you know, like, that would be crazy. But, I mean, like, some of Ryan Krauser's practice throws that he posts on, like, his Instagram or on YouTube are some of the most perfect, like, well, I know I just said, as close as you could get to perfect technical perfection as possible, all right? But sometimes he doesn't hit those positions in a meet. And also, when you're watching videos of a elite throw in practice, if they actually, like, are recording their voices and their coach is in the background or something like that, you get to actually see what they're working on and what their intent of the of their practice is, which, one, is fascinating, and two, you know, it shows them that they still work on stuff. They're human. So, yeah, that's something to keep in mind as well. Well, I mean, of course, watch competition because, you know, it's in one, it's important to see how they compete, how their technique changes from comp to competition to practice, and maybe you could carry that over to what you do. And especially if you watch, like, their warm-up throws in competition, see how they take warm-ups. And see, maybe you can try some of the stuff they do, and maybe it works for you if you haven't found something that works for you yet. So, yeah. But yeah, that's just something to keep in mind. And another reason why it might be a negative to look at elite throwers is because a lot of them do very weird stuff that normally people should not do. Because for those elite athletes, their technique is perfect for them, all right? Not everyone does a heel turn out the back like Reese Hoffa, but that's a very individual thing that he does, all right? Not everyone whines like Weiss Heidinger. Don't whine like Weiss Heidinger. I personally hate his technique. I don't care if he's throwing 70 meters. I don't like it. At me. Alright? I mean, sure, it's through 70 meters. Don't care. Don't like looking at it. But I'm about to be mad. So, yeah. So, you know, not everyone can have a high point like Gerd Kanter. Not everyone can have a first turn like Kibway Johnson, you know. Not everyone can have a penultimate to power position like, you know, Johannes Vetter. You know, like, just, you know, they do crazy stuff. You know, sometimes, you know, there's a reason why they're the best of the best, because they can do stuff that a lot of other throwers can't. You know, not a lot of jab throwers can hit the freaking splits when they go from into the penultimate. All right, like Johannes Vetter. All right? So, that's something to keep in mind. Not a lot of people can and should heel turn out the back like Reese Hoffa. Not a lot of people should have a super high left out the back like Adam Nelson. You know, there's things that they do that work for them, but will probably not work for you, because there's a reason why a lot of people don't throw like them. All right? So, that's something to keep in mind if you're watching film of these guys. Is don't get caught up in the little things that they do, all right? Because that's individual stuff, all right? So that's something to keep in mind. You gotta find what works for you. You are not Ryan Kauser. You are not Adam Nelson. You are not Johannes Vetter. You are not Kibway Johnson. You are not all these Olympians. That's not saying you're bad. It's just saying you're literally just not another human being. You are you. So find what works for you, all right? So, because I get questions all the time. Oh, maybe I should try this. Like, no, and here's why. And then I list out all the things I just told you, all right? So, yeah, that's basically my rant about why film has positive, negatives, when you should use it, why you should use it, whether watching yourself, watching other throwers. And yeah, let me know if you have any questions about this certain topic, because I don't think it gets talked about enough. I think people just watch film and don't actually do anything. If you want, I can do another video of how to actually analyze film and my approach to analyzing film. A thing that I would look up is look up Kobe Bryant watching film. I know it's a totally different sport, but it's the same concepts about how he approaches film sessions and stuff. It's something I don't think a lot of people talk about. I think I've seen Ryan Krauser talk about it like once or twice, but I'll give you a little sneak peek. Basically, like, if you go into a film session, cover it with a blank mind, pretend it's a totally different thrower you've never seen before, and just analyze it. Because if you look for one little thing that you think you're doing wrong, that all you're going to see is that, and you're going to miss a lot of things that you could improve on. All right, well, a lot of things that you do well, or a lot of things. You'll just miss a lot of things if you only focus on one thing that you're looking at. All right, so that's the summary of it, but I would highly recommend watching. Just type in on YouTube, like, Kobe Bryant film breakdown, or Kobe Bryant, like, breaking down film, or just something like that, and just... It's like an interview thing. I think he's like seated or something. I forget. I watched it like a year ago or something. But yeah. So, yeah. That's it. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments. And if you guys like me talking about stuff like this, you know, just do it. I got some time in the world. So, yeah. See y'all next time.